Good evening. Welcome to the program. You're listening to The Soapbox here on 90.9, 104.1 WMPG, Southern Maine's community radio from the University of Southern Maine. My name is Eric. Thanks for joining me this evening. This is still a relatively new talk show here on WMPG, so if you're just tuning in, the idea is that this Soapbox is provided by the community radio station that is WMPG. So the airwaves do not belong to me. They do not belong to WMPG. They are the public's airwaves. So you are cordially invited to join the conversation tonight, 780-4909, if you want to join the conversation. And typically we talk about fairly big ideas here on the Soapbox. And tonight will be no different. We will be discussing the nature of democracy and also a bit about totalitarianism, two different forms of totalitarianism, classical totalitarianism and inverted totalitarianism. And we'll be focusing probably more on the latter than the former, but it's important to understand the distinction between the two. But to begin the conversation tonight, I thought I would read you a quote or two from our Secretary of State, John Kerry. He just released an official statement today on the protests happening in the Ukraine. You can do a little Google search and find more about the protests in terms of the details of what's going on with them. But his reaction, of course, he's speaking for the state, the United States, the state. I thought really caught my eye. Here are some quotes. He says, quote, "The United States expresses its disgust with the decision of Ukrainian authorities to meet the peaceful protest in Kiev's Maidan Square with riot police, bulldozers, and batons, rather than with respect for democratic rights and human dignity. This response is neither acceptable nor does it befit a democracy." Big, bold, strong denunciations from the Secretary of State. Goes on to say, "Respect for democratic principles, including freedom of assembly, is fundamental to the United States' approach to Ukraine. This is a universal value, not just an American one. For weeks, we have called on President Yanukovych and his government to listen to the voices of his people who want peace, justice, and a European future. Instead, Ukraine's leaders appear tonight to have made a very different choice." So I came across that statement today and was, as you might expect, floored with the blatant, grotesque hypocrisy in this statement. He could very well be describing the official state-sanctioned response to the Occupy protests in this quote. Of course, the nature of our government is that we are immune to the definitions of the faults that we discover and point to in other states. When they do it, it's wrong. When we do it, not so much. So I thought tonight, since Secretary of State, our esteemed Secretary of State, John Kerry, brought up the topic, we would delve further into the topic of democracy. Just what exactly is this democracy that he is speaking of? What does it look like in our state and in other states? And philosophically, what is the idea behind it? So once again, if you want to join in, 780-4909. My name is Eric. Ed is manning the board over there. So let's jump into it. Democracy defined. Noam Chomsky offers a couple different definitions in his pamphlet, Media Control. He says, one conception of democracy, the more traditional conception of democracy, is that a democratic society is one in which the public has the means to participate in some meaningful way in the management of their own affairs, and the means of information are open and free. Moreover, democracy is an egalitarian system of self-governance by the people. There is another conception, or as he puts it, the prevailing American conception of democracy. And this says that the public must be barred from management of their own affairs, and the means of information must be kept narrowly and rigidly controlled. From here, you may be familiar with Noam Chomsky, but he talks a lot about Walter Lippmann and his characterization of the masses as the bewildered herd. And this is a theme that you can observe for yourself within the governance of our country, but also you can read about this theme in numerous writings, Walter Lippmann, Leo Strauss among the most prominent. But the idea is that the bewildered herd are too stupid to lead themselves. Their job is to be spectators, not participants. It is, in actuality, the role of the specialized class to lead the populace and to make the decisions for the bewildered herd, who are too stupid to make sound decisions of their own. And the specialized class is the enlightened few, who are capable of making such decisions. So as before, I mentioned Leo Strauss. He advocates, quote, life-giving delusions and the act of, quote, fabricating myths as methods to politically manage the masses, because the masses, of course, are meant to be managed and not to be active participants. It matters not that the purveyors of these delusions or myths don't believe them. It is what's good for the people that they are under the illusion that their leaders believe them, even if their leaders are smart enough to know that it's kind of BS. Strauss has been criticized as teaching that, quote, perpetual deception of the citizens by those in power is critical because they need to be led and they need strong rulers to tell them what's good for them. So I'd encourage you to look up Leo Strauss and find out more for yourself. He was an immigrant from Germany in, I believe it was 1938, and he is a man of considerable influence on the political powers that be in this country, most prominently, probably, that I've heard of is Paul Wolfowitz, who was the president of the World Bank, which, of course, is an international bank. He was also the United States ambassador to Indonesia and the U.S. Deputy Secretary of Defense under George W. Bush Jr. And he was working for Donald Rumsfeld when he was there. So presumably Rumsfeld was familiar with Wolfowitz's beliefs. I mean, Wolfowitz is a known Straussian. So he believes in these life-giving delusions and the need to fabricate myths. So in the context of what Wolfowitz and Rumsfeld and the Bush administration did in terms of getting us into a war, this notion of fabricating myths should ring somewhat true to you. So the bewildered herd is occasionally allowed to throw their lot behind one of the specialized class, saying, we want you to lead us, but never we lead ourselves. We never really have much more authority as members of the bewildered herd to exercise any sort of autonomous control over our fates. Our obligation is to cast our lots with one of the specialized class. Of course, in an actual democracy, the people would lead. We would not be choosing one from a specialized class or a separate group of people. So I'm going to read you another quote from Noam Chomsky here. This is still from Media Control. I'm going to try and blow through some of the discussion around his book, because there's other stuff I'd like to talk about tonight too. But I think this concept of the bewildered herd versus the specialized classes is an important understanding in terms of how our current quote-unquote democratic system is constructed. So he says, we need something to tame the bewildered herd. This is Chomsky speaking now. And that something is this new revolution in the art of democracy, the manufacture of consent. The media, the schools, and popular culture have to be divided. This is something we talk about frequently on the show. For the political class and the decision makers that have to provide them some tolerable sense of reality, although they also have to instill the proper beliefs. Just remember, there is an unstated premise here. The unstated premise, and even the responsible men have to disguise this from themselves, has to do with the question of how they get into the position where they have the authority to make decisions. The way they do that, of course, is by serving people with real power. The people with real power are the ones who own the society, which is a pretty narrow group. If the specialized class can come along and say, I can serve your interests, then they'll be a part of the executive group. You've got to keep that quiet. That means they have to have instilled in them the beliefs and doctrines that will serve the interests of private power. Unless they can master that skill, they're not part of the specialized class. So we have one kind of educational system directed to the responsible men, the specialized class. They have to be deeply indoctrinated in the values and interests of private power and the state corporate nexus that represents it. If they can achieve that, then they can be part of the specialized class. The rest of the bewildered herd basically just have to be distracted. Turn their attention to something else. Keep them out of trouble. Make sure that they remain, at most, spectators of action, occasionally lending their weight to one or another of the real leaders who they may select among. So there is something awfully pernicious and condescending about this conception of democracy. And it goes back to something we talked about during our first show here on the Soapbox, which you may or may not have heard, but there are competing notions of what to do in response to what most agree is a common problem among democracy. And that problem is, of course, the power of the masses. Because what will happen is if you have a anti-egalitarian society, and by that I mean if you have a wealthy, ruling, plutocratic class of landowners and wealth owners, if you give voting power to the masses, of course, their power is derived from the very notion that there are more of them than this select few privileged class. And so what will they do with that power? They will take the wealth and redistribute it amongst themselves. They will create a more egalitarian society and a society that more closely benefits their interests and their needs and their community's interests and needs. So this is the problem of democracy. Most people agree that that is the problem. And back at the there were two competing solutions to that problem that we mentioned in the first episode of the Soapbox here. We talked about the Aristotelian approach, which is to limit inequality. He says if you limit inequality, then that problem of democracy won't be a problem anymore because there won't be competing factions of classes that are at odds. That was not the solution that we undertook when writing our Constitution for the United States of America. James Madison had a different approach. The Madisonian approach was to reduce democracy. So you create a buffer between the government system and the people to impede their ability to actually exercise any authority or autonomy over the governance of the country. There are arguments for that. And it's a valid question that is worthy of discussion. I'm bringing this up for that purpose. I'm not necessarily suggesting any conclusions. I certainly have opinions, but But that is the problem, and those are the competing solutions. You either limit democracy or you limit inequality. And I think if you look around this country right now, you'll see which direction we've chosen. It's also stated historical fact that the founders, the drafters of the Constitution, recognized this problem and felt the need, the explicit need, to limit the control of the masses. So, of course, the power of the bewildered herd, as we are derisively called, is such that it has historically won victories during significant downturn episodes in the past. The right to vote for women, the right to vote for minorities, poor people, young people, minimum wages, overtime pay, 40-hour work week, regulations in the workplace, anti-trust regulation, much of the New Deal. The power of the bewildered herd is our power. We are the bewildered herd. And it's our obligation to do justice to the people, our ancestors who fought for these advances. And it's our solemn obligation to carry that fight on. Of course, those advances have been in the process of being rolled back for some time now and are under direct threat by our government. And I don't say this to incite any great fear or hunger for revolution or anything, but I do think it's important for us to recognize that there is a need among the underclasses, the working classes, the vast majority of this country, to organize, to pull together, and to unite, and to discover the strength therein, and to reclaim the shape of and the direction, the trajectory of this democracy. So it could be the power of the bewildered herd, as it won those advances, was of course recognized historically by the anti-democratic forces in this country, and was ruthlessly snuffed out through red baiting, McCarthyism, anti-communism, anti-socialism, anti-unionism, all of these things that to this day this country abhors. It is a scourge to be labeled a communist or a socialist, of course. People call Obama, President Obama, a socialist. He couldn't be anything further from a socialist, really. But all of these are symptoms from the historical purging that took place after the advances during the New Deal era of the left or progressivists or the masses, whatever you would like to call it. And the way that the right or the ruling classes, the specialized class, chose to destroy it was through this appeal to patriotism and nationalism. And this is a common strategy that has been used in other fascist, other totalitarian states in the past, Germany and Italy among them. There was a systematic dismantling of the left in those countries and a shift rightward before the ascension to power of the fascistic totalitarian governments in those countries. 780-4909 if you want to join in this conversation. To be clear, let me just say, I am not building to a conclusion that suggests that we are on the verge of becoming Nazi Germany. What I am suggesting, however, is that in this country there is the capacity, pretty nefarious capacity, for what political philosopher Sheldon Wolin calls an inverted totalitarianism. So traditionally, classical totalitarianism is concerned with not so much with what you think in private. You're free to think whatever you think in private. Classical totalitarianism doesn't have to worry about that because they have the threat of violence with which they coerce you to act, to do what they consider to be right actions and fall in line with the state's wishes and dictates. In an inverted totalitarian state, we don't have the luxury of the bludgeon to threaten the masses with. So the system is much more concerned with manipulating what people think. And Noam Chomsky spends a lot of time talking about this in his books, particularly, most notably, Manufacturing Consent, also this media control pamphlet that I was talking about. And this system that takes place is not the same as classical totalitarianism in the sense that there is some fascistic lone leader that rises to prominence and asserts his will on the polity and demands conformity. In inverted totalitarianism, it's really division that rules. The population is divided and marginalized and kept away from the reins of power. And the system naturally evolves into this shape rather than being forced into it by a specific ruler. It's almost an incidental happenstance that is born out of a number of circumstances and self-interested parties sort of quarreling and pushing the country in a certain direction. 7804909 to join the conversation. You're listening to The Soapbox on 90.9 and 104.1 WMPG. My name is Eric. So, one other thing from, maybe a few other things from this book by Noam Chomsky, but one thing he mentions that really struck me as stark was that if you ask the average American, when he wrote this book, which I think was probably about 10 years ago, if you ask the average American what the number of Vietnam casualties during our misadventure there was, the average American response would be about 100,000 Vietnam casualties. So the official figure was 2 million, and the actual figure, it has now come to be known, is more like 3 or 4 million. So that disparity between 100,000 and 3 or 4 million casualties as a result of our incursion into that state is striking. And he poses the question, what would we think about German political culture if, when you asked people today how many Jews died in the Holocaust, they estimated about 300,000? He leaves the answer unsaid, but I won't. It's morally repugnant. It's reprehensible that people would treat so cavalierly the loss of life at our state's hands. It's our responsibility to hold our government accountable for those types of actions. And it's our responsibility to inform ourselves and remain educated on how our government is acting, supposedly in our interests, but always in our name, overseas and in other countries. Of course, Noam Chomsky points to that and indicates that as a symptom of the mass propagandistic system that we have in this country. That is a success of the inverted totalitarian propagandistic system, which misleads the public and treats us as passive spectators as opposed to active participants willingly engaging in the democratic process. Excuse me. So Noam Chomsky goes on to say, organization has its effects. It means you discover that you're not alone. This is what we talk about frequently here on the show. Also, others have the same thoughts that you do. And that is the danger of democracy. If organizations can develop, if people are no longer just glued to the tube, you may have all these funny thoughts arising in their heads, like sickly inhibitions against the use of military force. That has to be overcome, but it hasn't been overcome, he says. And he's alluding specifically there to something called the Vietnam Syndrome, which was symptomized by the sickly inhibitions against the use of military force by the masses. And this was something that troubled the specialized class in this country because it impeded their imperialist impulses. Of course, those sickly inhibitions are manifestations of democratic character. We as a populace in a supposedly democratic society are free to feel inhibited about whatever we feel inhibited, and to express those inhibitions in whatever manner, in whatever constructive manner we deem necessary. Sometimes, well, I won't go there, but okay, so he goes on, the issue is much broader. It's whether we want to live in a free society or whether we want to live under what amounts to a form of self-imposed totalitarianism, what we're calling inverted totalitarianism, or what Sheldon Wolin calls inverted. With the bewildered herd marginalized, directed elsewhere, terrified, screaming patriotic slogans, fearing for their lives and admiring with awe the leader who saved them from destruction, while the educated masses goose-step on command and repeat the slogans they're supposed to repeat, and the society deteriorates at home. So this is what I'm suggesting. This is where I'm suggesting we find ourselves in this country currently. If you're interested in learning more about this, incidentally, you can find more information on the Soapbox's Facebook page. That's just facebook.com/thesoapboxportland. And again, the books I'm referring to here, there's Noam Chomsky's Media Control, and also Sheldon Wolin wrote a great book called Democracy Incorporated, Managed Democracy and the Specter of Inverted Totalitarianism. I'd recommend that book in particular. So there's something, as I said, insulting about this, and we really have to ask ourselves, as members of the bewildered herd, what kind of a democracy do we wish to live in? Do we want to live in the current prevailing conception of democracy, which is one that limits our power, marginalizes us, and divides us? Or do we want to live in a truly egalitarian democratic society? If it is the latter, then we need to organize and we need to unite and begin to exert the power which is rightfully ours. So that's just about it for tonight. Again, check out The Soapbox on Facebook. It's facebook.com/thesoapboxportland. My name is Eric. Thanks for joining me this evening. And you can reach me on Facebook, and if you want to jump in the conversation there, jump in anytime, please. So, again, thanks to Ed, and stick around here on WMPG. Byron is coming up next. Have a wonderful night.